lovelies, Charisse here, your online therapist. This is week two's roundup, just to consolidate everything and to give you some of my thoughts and to go into a little bit more detail about stuff. I've really enjoyed this week. I feel like there's been a lot of really interesting stuff put out there, and I've really enjoyed your guys' interaction and obviously also your messages to me, so thank you so much for that. The beginning part of therapy, there's a lot of time spent on raising our awareness, really trying to understand why we do what we do, why we react the way we do, why we choose the partners that we do, etc., etc., etc. Because everything that we do, everything that we have in our lives, there will be a reason for that. There will be an explanation of some sort. And that's a big function of therapy, is raising awareness, raising consciousness, because we just aren't aware. We are in denial about certain things. We also minimize certain things. These are all defenses that protect us from pain, from difficulty. But actually, if we use those defenses too much, what it does is it disempowers us to be able to do anything about our struggles. So we have to spend quite a bit of effort working on ourselves and raising our awareness. We need to be self-aware people. Otherwise, we are ignorant to ourselves. We are ignorant to what matters to us and what maybe some parts of us that are wounded need to be healed. So it's really important that we raise our awareness about stuff. And that's why I spoke about denial this week. And all the information I gave this week was about, does this sound like you? Does this resonate? What are your patterns? Let's really spend some time thinking about this. So first things first, let me speak about my anxiety post around negative self-talk, because I love this subject. It's very close to my heart and it's just key to so many things. Negative self-talk is huge in mental health. We are critical of ourselves, we are cruel to ourselves, and this actually just becomes so normalized that we almost don't realize how we are putting ourselves down on an almost constant basis. So if we think about this even for a second, we can realize, okay, that's probably not too helpful as I go about life trying to do things. If I'm constantly telling myself how unlikely it is that I will succeed, how cowardly I am, how weak I am, how silly it is to do that. You know, all of that keeps us very, very stuck. Stuck in our anxiety, stuck in our depression, but also just stuck in our lives. Criticism and negativity and tough love has really been shown by research to not motivate people. It actually reduces people's agency and their understanding of their ability. So actually, the negative self-talk is profoundly unhelpful. It in fact keeps us sick. So it's really important, and I always work on this with my clients. We've got to start challenging the negative self-talk. It's absolutely counterproductive and in fact self-destructive. So really begin to notice what you are saying about yourself, the messages that you are sending to yourself about life, about your relationship, about how you cope, and start noticing if they are deeply negative, if they're critical, if they're harsh, because we have to start challenging that and introduce something gentler, softer, and more encouraging. As we would say to someone else, we need to encourage ourselves. This is about our relationship with ourselves. Do we want to have a supportive, loving, inspiring relationship with ourselves? Or do we want to beat ourselves up and keep ourselves in a place whereby we cannot do what we want to do and we cannot achieve what we want to achieve? So the negative self-talk is so important. I'll come back to this a million times because it's very pervasive and we have to keep challenging it, and we have to really be aware of just how much it is happening in our lives and the part that it plays in our lives with sabotaging what we want. So I also spoke about where our relationship issues come from, some of the patterns that we may have been experiencing in our lives. Again, this is about raising awareness, understanding this happened, so actually now I'm a bit scared of that. or this is an experience that I had, and so now I'm a bit reticent to get involved again, or I feel like all people are actually untrustworthy, or I can only expect very little from relationships. It's sort of, we have to begin to understand that our past experiences shape our understanding today of the world. You know, when we're growing up, we are constantly, we're like sponges, we are constantly absorbing information about what can I expect, what is the world like, are people good, will I be looked after, is everything okay? And if we had inconsistency in our childhoods, if we had parents who were human, who probably had their own issues, we were absorbing a lot of stuff that we just need to question now. How helpful is that? Is that true? Is the world that unsafe? Can I look after myself more now as a fully functioning adult than I did and could have when I was little? Because we're often living our emotions are often in the past, and we need to start living in the real world, in the reality of today. Okay, we have a lot of agency, a lot of strength, and we can start bringing that to ourselves. But emotionally, we're often living in the past, and the stuff that happened in the past that was unhelpful, that's kind of where we emotionally get a bit stuck. So I was really trying to raise awareness about that in some of the posts this week, and this is going to be something that obviously I keep doing loads of. Finally, I really want to talk about triggers and transference, because this is massive in therapy. Any of you who've been to therapy will know this. We get triggered all the time in our days. Something happens that's sufficiently familiar to us about something that's happened in our past, and we automatically react. It's often extraordinarily fast. We immediately react and we feel this surge of emotion, and we start making up all sorts of things about often a very small exchange. Oh, this person doesn't care about me. Oh, you know, my life is in danger here. I need to react fiercely. This is what the language that we use around this is, that we've been triggered. There's a past pain, often a past trauma, that's been triggered in us, and we are then reacting from that place of fight or flight or survive, and I have to have a big emotion here because I'm about to be destroyed. And we are not about to be destroyed. We're probably trying to have a loving relationship. We're probably just trying to do our jobs. We are probably just going about our day, and everyone else is going about their day and not thinking about us as much as we think that they are. So we are just triggered all of the time. And it's very important to begin to recognize that, because when we're in the emotional space of being triggered, we feel so justified in how we feel. We feel justified to be furious with our partners or with our work colleague or with someone else on the street who's behaving badly. We feel justified. We are self-righteous. We are indignant. We are furious. That's the key to recognizing when we're triggered, when it's overwhelming emotion. And it takes us over and we're consumed by it. And then we start making decisions and start behaving from that place. So we can be so reactive, we can be so destructive, we can say things that are highly unhelpful to our relationships, to our jobs, to our lives. And we're doing it all kind of not even aware that we're triggered, and we're operating from a place that's actually in the past. As I said, we're engaging in time travel. You know, actually we're not in the here and now, where someone's done something frustrating or irritating or deeply upsetting, but the level of our reaction is so disproportionate, we're triggered. We are triggered. And that, the bigger term for that is known as transference. Is that we're transferring something from the past, something massive, or lots of things that have happened in our life into this moment now. And the pain and upset and frustration from the past or all these experiences arrives in this present moment and is explosive emotionally and behaviorally in that moment. So it can be so destructive. And we are drunk with it. We're not even aware of it. And then we can end up doing massive damage that we then have to perhaps try to recover, or we just start living in this reality of, yeah, this is what's happening. Like last time, this is what's happening now all over again, when actually we've lost the plot. We are not in reality. We're not in the here and now. We're living in the past. So making these distinctions and raising our awareness about getting to grips with this is so key, because you will not believe how much this happens in life. People upset us, we make assumptions about them, we project things onto them, we do these transferences, we live in a place of being triggered a lot of the time. And actually, this is again, like last week, like I was saying, this is where we have to breathe. Because when we're triggered, the part of our brain that is able to reason, problem solve, work things out, be patient, that part of our brain shuts down because we go into survival mode. So we have to calm the body and the brain down. Okay, we're not surviving. Our life is not in danger. We're okay. Take some breaths. Take a time out. That might be minutes, hours, or days. And as you allow yourself to calm, you can then, the part of your brain that can be rational can come in and say, actually, yeah, that was tough. But you know what? It wasn't so tough that you had to fight for the death in that moment. Or, oh my God, that really reminded me of that last time I was hurt or rejected or something really bad happened. And I guess I felt like that was happening again. Or, oh my goodness, this is a dynamic that my partner and I get into all of the time and I don't fully understand it. I need to spend some time really figuring this out. This is how we grow. This is how we get well. And this is how we really invest in our mental health. So it is such a key thing to know about, and it's a really key strategy to begin to understand. I need to slow down. The bigger my emotions, there just needs to be a little warning bell, warning, I'm having massive emotions, I'm feeling overwhelmed, I need to take time to figure out what's happening because I'm probably not thinking clearly. And we do this thing that I always say, which is damage limitation. Don't go too damaging into your life. If it's too big and you feel overwhelmed, step away. Take time to think about what you're doing and choose how you're going to respond. If everyone in the world did that, we would live in a very different world. So those are just some of my reflections on this week. As always, please send me your comments and questions, and I'll keep growing week on week. And I'll see you next week for the next roundup. Thanks, guys. See you soon.